Welcome to CNS Inspire series of interviews featuring conversations with people who have made commendable contribution over the years for health and development justice. Each interview of CNS Inspire series explores what went well and not so well in the past 10-20 years and how can we accelerate progress towards not only issue-specific goals and targets but also for integrated development of all. Success breeds complacency. And complacency breeds failure. Beginning from ground zero in fight against AIDS decades back, now is not a time for any complacency. Rather, it's the best time to consolidate our efforts towards ending AIDS by 2030. With this backdrop, let us introduce a very special guest today, Dr. Raman R. Gangakhedkar, who is presently the director in charge of India's Apex Government HIV Research Institute, formerly known as National AIDS Research Institute of Indian Council of Medical Research, or ICMR. He started working on HIV in 1989, very soon after the first case got diagnosed in the country. At that time, he was based in Mumbai and subsequently shifted to Pune when NARI was established in 1993. He has been an eminent clinician, scientist, and also intensely involved in devising guidelines in almost every aspect of HIV management for national government as well as the National AIDS Control Program and policymaking at the country level. He was in conversation with CNS Managing Editor Shobha Shukla on the sidelines of 9th National Conference of AIDS Society of India, or SECON 2016. Without any further delay, let's listen to what Dr. Raman R. Gangakhedkar shares.
With your vast experience of spanning nearly 3 decades, would you like to share some processes or some actions which took place, of which you were also part of, which have proved to be game changers in your field?
I think there were many changes, game changers, as you would say. In HIV. The first one to my mind which was most important was community involvement in decision making. It was not only community mobilization as the first step that was taken, but it went beyond even sex workers, MSM or an injecting drug users leader could perhaps sit with all of us and try to give their opinions on any policy that was being established or even programmatic strategy to reach them. The second thing which was a major game changer was the program was always dependent on World Bank or GFATM all through. However, in 1999, the first investment, national investment that came was for PPTCT program in India. Though it was very small, to my mind that made a major difference because the government then started thinking in terms of putting in its own money rather than being dependent on the donors' money as such. And once the PPTCT program started, it paved way to free ART programming. It was much more easier to start free ART program because people, there used to be a concern at that time that the policymakers or the ministers, they may not support the political advocacy, would perhaps fall short just because HIV then was known as disease of those who are socially marginalized or socially excluded population. But once PPTCT was given to the mainstream population, it paved way for free ART programming, and I think that was a big game changer because so far in the history, we had never given free treatment for any person of chronic disease which requires a lifelong kind of a treatment. But that big and bold step could be taken only because of PPTCT program and the government could come on board.
Where we could have done better, or we faltered on in some areas?
There are few areas where we can do better. One perhaps is ensuring quality of services for PPTCT as well as free ART programming. If I can improve that quality of service, then in that case perhaps we should be in a better position to control the epidemic, because today treatment as prevention is a concept that is widely regarded as the biggest component of controlling HIV infection. The second perhaps thing which can be improved is, though India, based on its own local evidences of the epidemic, started focused or prioritized interventions among key subpopulations of sex workers, MSM and injecting drug users, and then migrants as well. However, the larger goal, that this was first started with NGOs as such, so there was a CBO or NGO which was always involved in it, but when NGOs are working, they act as gatekeepers. One of the larger goals that we still have is community itself should be involved as a community-based organization. The community should lead the targeted interventions that we are thinking about, and that perhaps has still not happened. We have to move beyond on that. The third issue, which is also important, is when these are marginalized populations, these are disempowered populations. And when you empower them, empowerment should not only be until the time that they are able to prevent HIV infection. You have to move beyond. You have to look at it as a holistic concept, that the community has to be empowered in every possible comprehensive manner, so as these people will never remain vulnerable to any disease, and which essentially means that I need to still think in terms of empowering them, make their voices stronger, and ensure that the inequity in power between mainstream population and the key subpopulations is reduced to the minimum possible.
What way do you think you can contribute to this community engagement and empowerment?
Community engagement, I think for community engagement, we need to be open. We need to be only advocates. We need to ensure that we provide right kind of support to these organizations to lead by themselves. But we should not be part of that organization. And that kind of advocacy is perhaps something which I see I would be doing strongly in coming years, because I believe that the community structurally led interventions should also have complete control on all components of prevention and treatment services, which would essentially mean the community-based HIV testing has to improve. You use the same communities to do the same, and at the same time, you should also envision that tomorrow even ART center for these subpopulations should be actually hosted in these community-based organizations, and community should deliver care. Only small support of technical support should come, like a doctor or a pharmacist. If the community doesn't have, perhaps they could hire. And if that happens, then there will be a holistic empowerment of the community, because when they start managing their own programs, it in itself adds so much of capacity to them that they will be able to even manage their own problems, which may be health related, which may not be health related. It just doesn't matter.
Now we have the SDGs, which tell us that we have to eliminate HIV AIDS by 2030. So just carrying on forward from that, what you have said just now, what do you think India now needs to do? Maybe just 4 or 5 doable and specific and measurable steps which need to be taken.
I think one of the most important thing is, today we know that we have been able to perhaps detect, in according to National AIDS Control Program, detect and link only 14 lakh HIV infected individuals, which still means that I have still 7 lakh estimated people who still don't know that they are HIV infected. Now they will only know if they develop symptoms. So we need to have prioritized community-based testing, which should be intensified all over the country. Unless we do that, we will not know more number of HIV infected individuals. The second thing which I feel is most important is, So far, in the process of rapid scale up that we wanted, we may not have had paid adequate attention to quality of services. And if I try to improve quality of services, only then I will be able to ensure that the last 90 goal of maintaining virologic suppression can ever be achieved. And we have to minimize those loss to follow-up related issues or people who have low adherence. The third thing which I must talk about is, even if the epidemic is on a decline, today the numbers sound small when we say 21 lakh people. But we need, if we want to go for elimination of HIV, virtual elimination of HIV, in that case we may have to intensify our efforts rather than diluting our efforts. When the numbers become small, there is a tendency that people tend to say this is no longer a public health problem. But if you want elimination, then you will have to intensify every aspect and then try and see that HIV could be eliminated. Whether it is in prioritized states that you may have to intensify your focus, or prioritized populations for a given state, I think we need to think in terms of intensifying the strategies as such. The fourth important issue is, we have to start having implementation research in HIV. Now, this implementation research is vital because it will identify not only the gaps but also the solutions at each level wherever somebody is implementing the program. A decentralized approach to understand, decode those evidences, try and understand what are my gaps, and letting a completely decentralized approach towards modification of policies is a vital step, because you can't have one can't be wearing one suit that fits all. You need to have strategies which are locally adapted, for which we may have to go for capacity building of all those who are involved in interventions, so that they can interpret those evidences and actually modify them. And the last, I still believe, is empowering key populations is a vital thing. Unless we do that, we will never achieve. If I don't empower them, they will perhaps today remain free of HIV infection, but over a period of time, their biological, behavioral vulnerabilities, as well as their social vulnerabilities, will continue to be there, and that might provide a chance for HIV again to hit back because of complacency.
Looking back on these years with which you have been totally involved with this, you must have seen ups and downs, positive, negative actions. Would you like to share some of your proud moments?
The first one, if I recall, was a paper when I wrote. It was a very simple paper. It doesn't require so much of accolade. But it was a time when the stigma associated with HIV was very high. And while doing a longitudinal study among STI patients, I wrote a paper where we found that married monogamous women were having very high HIV prevalence and HIV incidence. Now, for this particular paper, we could not link these women to their husbands, though we also knew that husbands are also coming to the same clinic, because we had not taken ethics permission to link, and post facto we could never do it. But that paper was a landmark paper. It only told that married monogamous women acquire HIV infection not because of their risk behavior, but because of the behaviors of their husbands. And that opened up entire policymakers group to a concept that we have to have women-centric prevention approaches. We need to prioritize those approaches. And this was one paper which was extensively used for advocacy related to HIV infection all over in Southeast Asia region. They used to say 94% of these women who acquired HIV infection were married and monogamous. So the focus was suddenly shifted. Not only earlier the focus used to be only on sex workers as women, when it came to women, but suddenly the focus shifted towards women in mainstream population, and then the interventions related to PPTCT could come in. The second time, second proud moment, as you say, I had come from Hopkins after doing MPH in 1996, and I wanted to start work because I realized only one thing, that you can't make the system responsive unless you go for mainstream population. Now for mainstream, I thought PPTCT, or earlier days it used to be called as prevention of mother to child transmission, was one of the key areas, because the treatment was there. You could provide certain drugs like Zidovudine at that time, and you could prevent transmission to the baby, and I thought that was a sellable idea. So when I came, I started working over that, and then I submitted a proposal to Government of India, which was also supported by UNICEF, and we started the entire program, first with a feasibility study in 11 centers. We started on Zidovudine based Bangkok regimen, then we shifted to single dose nevirapine regimen, only because that was easy for the system to handle. But once we started, by 2001 the program started, and that program was a landmark program, and I feel that I was lucky to be able to roll it out at that juncture. The third one, which if I could say, was a proud moment for me from a different angle. I was originally a pediatrician. I had nothing to do with sex workers or MSM. I didn't know what are they and how do they live. But when I was working with different NGOs, and Gilada's was also one, for the first time I started going to red light areas, and as a typical Indian male from a conservative society, I used to feel I was always awkward when I used to go into those red light areas. But that particular aspect improved over a time only because I started going to red light areas. I saw how these women live, and when there were riots, Bombay riots that occurred following the bomb blast, we used to go in the curfew situation, because our worry was that if these women don't get anything to earn money in those circumstances, they may practice unsafe behaviors. So we borrowed grains, people were there to donate the grains, and we used to prepare rice and dal. That used to be done by few philanthropic hotels, you know, they used to do prepare it for us. And during the curfew time, we used to go, we took a permission from the police, and we went in the red light areas. Every night we used to feed them, and that, I think, it made me understand what is social exclusion and how these people live their life, and it made me more committed. And subsequently we started working more with Dr. Thakur. I started working more on structurally community-led interventions, where pictorial tools could be used by sex workers to manage their own program as to how it, because illiteracy is very common among them. But I think that opened my eyes, and it made me comfortable, and more importantly, advocate for these women to be taken to policymakers' place and ask them to be sensitive to their demands and understand how epidemic can be tackled.
And it must have also increased their trust in you.
Trust, definitely. Definitely.
Seeing that, they must definitely have realized that these are the people who really care.
Now, there were actually movements in Pune. I used to go even in red light area to see patients. Because these women used to call, she is very sick. Sir, she can't come, will you come here? But it can only happen if you are sensitized better. I think everybody has, commitment is always there, but it's only an issue of sensitization. Then you start doing good for the community.
Okay, lastly, would you like to share a few learnings with those who are new to the field or entering this field, and what would be your key messages for them?
Yeah, I think the first thing which we must do as youngsters must always remember that you treat your patient as your equal. Whether they belong to any subpopulation, whether they are poor, whether whatever they are, but you need to have an approach based on equality. Only then we can make a difference among them. Otherwise we remain prescriptive in our approach, and which is not healthy for anybody. The second thing is you need to be very passionate about whatever you are doing, whichever cause. No, it is not necessary you work only for HIV. You work on any disease, but be passionate and inquisitive. Never fear to challenge whoever it is, whether it is an authority. Never fear if you see a paper in a respected journal like Lancet, whether I can say the paper could be, paper has certain limitations. There is no such thing as hierarchy in science. You need to be bold enough and make your statements. Perhaps some of your statements will be understood and people will follow what you are saying. Be always ambitious. Unless you aim at moon, you will never reach anywhere. Now, the reason why I am stating this is when we started our careers in HIV, there was no treatment, nothing. We used to only keep on counseling people, help them. But when people start working just like this, and if you actually honestly ask me, those days when there was no treatment, sometimes used to feel so frustrated that as a doctor, I'm not giving medicine. I'm only speaking and trying to alleviate his anxiety. But you can make a difference, because you know, as long as you continue to go on the same path, your ambition will be achieved. I can only say one way, I could have had worked in any other disease. But first disease that I chose was sickle cell disease, where there is no treatment. Because I told my director that I don't want to work on something which is easily treatable. Because that anybody will do. You don't need to do that. And then came HIV. And HIV also had similar facets. There was nothing. But unless you work and be ambitious that I can make a difference, I could do something, perhaps you will always make a difference. And last, which is most important, is you need to learn to advocate excellently. You need to have certain good communication skills. The way you present your thought, perhaps you will make a difference. Don't think that advocacy should only be done by NGOs. There are different ways of doing advocacy. You need to learn different facets of making doing advocacy. You will always make a difference.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
We were listening to Dr. Raman R. Gangakhedkar, who is the director in charge of National AIDS Research Institute of Indian Council of Medical Research, or ICMR. He was in conversation with CNS Managing Editor Shobha Shukla. This interview is part of CNS Inspired series, featuring conversations with people who have made commendable contribution over the years for development justice. Each interview of CNS Inspired series explores what went well and not so well in the past 10-20 years, and how can we accelerate progress towards not only issue-specific goals and targets, but also for integrated development of all. For more details, be welcome to check out our website www.citizen-news.org. Thanks for listening, and stay tuned for our next episode of CNS Inspire series next Tuesday. Goodbye.